Sonoma State Hospital, specializing in the care and treatment of the retarded of all ages, located in Sonoma Valley, Eldridge, California. The headbangers, a small group of children who can be found in almost any state hospital or institution where disturbed or retarded children are cared for. Even though they constitute a small group, their symptom is dramatic and sometimes requires immediate and constant attention. There's very little to be found written in medical and psychiatric literature regarding these pathological headbangers, except as passing observations. To my knowledge, at the making of this film, there is nothing written on the treatment of this condition, and only occasional speculations in the literature as to its etiology. In this film, an attempt is made to broadly outline the problem, generally explore one approach to studying these children, and in some detail discuss one such child. We called our project the Intensive Study Unit for the Emotionally Disturbed. In retrospect, this is probably misleading since it implies etiology. A better name would be the Intensive Study Unit for the Behaviorally Disturbed. We were given a 6-bed unit where each child had his own private room, a bedstand where they could keep a few of their own things, and a window low enough for them to see the outside world. That is, with the exception of the two children who are additionally blind, a blindness which is self-inflicted. But even for them, the windows have proven of value, for Jeanne, who you will learn more about, will often lie in bed early in the morning and follow the warmth of the sun as it moves through her room and across the bed. Few visitors were allowed on the unit as we tried to limit the number and kind of outside stimuli which could impinge on these children. Before we opened our doors to patients, a 2-day conference was held specifically for the new staff. Our discussions ranged from the treatment of autistic children to a broad outline of normal and abnormal ego growth and development. After the 2 days, we had begun to develop group cohesiveness with a clear goal in mind. The intensive observation of a small group of very self-destructive children with the hope of understanding them better, and at the end of a 6-month period, to have gathered enough information to develop a rational treatment program for such children. Headbanging, as mentioned earlier, is a symptom to be found in almost any hospital or institution dealing with children, whether their diagnosis is mental retardation or mental illness. Rhythmic head or bodily motions are often precursors to such behavior, and the headbanging itself can be either of a rhythmic nature or occur in sporadic, explosive outbursts. The headbangers we are talking about in this film more often than not require intermittent and sometimes constant 24-hour restraint for self-protection, since if left alone, they will inflict severe damage to themselves, often requiring some form of surgical treatment. Some of the children require only a helmet, and as long as this is in place, no attempt is made to strike their head, and usually no effort is made to injure any other part of their body. In other headbangers, all 4 extremities and their head must be restrained 24 hours a day, or severe damage will occur to the free extremity or to the portion of the body accessible to blows from that free extremity. Interestingly enough, 2 of the children on our project are blind, due entirely to repeated and severe blows to the eyes, occurring over months and years. If allowed to, some of these children seem to progressively attempt to shut out the world by first beating their eyes until they are swollen shut, and then slapping or banging their ears as if to numb the sound. This child needs the protection and security of her helmet. When it is removed, she will almost immediately begin slapping herself about the face. This is one of the children who is now blind due to repeated self-inflicted trauma. When the helmet is replaced, no attempt is made to remove it by the child, and she is again able to lie back down quietly and restrain her hands in her dress. the children on our ward began to improve, many forms of rhythmic behavior were seen to occur increasingly frequently where they had not been observed before, at least in the recent history of each particular child. Head rolling was observed in two of the children, and this is behavior that is described as a frequent precursor of normal head banging in infants. Other forms of rhythmic behavior, such as rocking in a rocking chair, bouncing on the bed, or squeaking a squeak toy rhythmically, were forms of apparently substitutive behavior, although head banging was quickly resorted to if the child was frustrated in one way or another. Jeanne is one of the five children we have been working with since the start of the project. The first pictures we have of her were at the age of 7 months. Up to this time, no difficulty was openly suspected. At the age of 8 months, she had an illness with a high fever. Her mother said that in the fever, she hit the side rails of the bed. An ear infection was subsequently diagnosed. After this illness, it is reported she was lethargic, did not react to sound, and in general showed only minimal interest to her surroundings. When she was 3 years old, a diagnosis was made of physical and mental retardation. Except for her characteristic tense look, most of the photographs of her do not demonstrate any unusual appearance, although medical reports have been consistent in describing her as mentally retarded and intermittently aggressive towards herself. The cause of her condition, however, was not and has not been diagnosed. At the age of 5, shortly after this series of pictures were taken, a medical report states she was examined with great difficulty as she acted like a small, wild animal. She was constantly biting. When about 6 years old, she was placed in a foster home because her mother had become unable to take care of her. At first, she was in restraint because she was self-abusive. But after a few months, she was able to get along without restraints, although she would occasionally strike her head, usually out of frustration. These next pictures are excerpts of home movies made on Jeanne's 10th birthday. The first several scenes are in slow motion. As you can see, she tended to move away from people even then. Her tense, shy manner is also apparent. Here she was being pulled in a wagon and abruptly began a series of bizarre gestures with her hands, which stopped as suddenly as they started. The rest of the pictures are at the normal speed and again convey her tenseness. There is no evidence of self-destructive behavior from these pictures, however. This series of pictures was taken when Jeanne was going on 11 years. About 8 months before she was admitted to Sonoma State Hospital. An examiner who saw her at that time described her as having a faraway look in her eyes, and she would usually not respond when spoken to. Every so often she would suddenly bite her hand. After Jeanne was admitted to Sonoma, she continued to be self-abusive, and finally required 24-hour restraint for her own safety. Attempts to calm her with the use of tranquilizing drugs repeatedly failed. She was being considered for lobotomy just prior to being admitted to our unit because a number of consultants had agreed her behavior appeared hopelessly intractable. At this point, Jeanne is 14 years old. She is totally and irreversibly blind due to repeated self-inflicted injury to her eyes, and she has been the way you see her for over a year. There was nothing that had been found to calm Jeanne consistently. Occasionally she would quiet down for a few days, but always quickly revert to this kind of behavior, especially when anyone approached her. This is the day Jeanne was being transferred to the intensive study unit. At this point, Jeanne had been on our project for about a week and a half. She began to be able to lie quietly for increasingly longer periods of time, but always became upset if anyone persisted in staying with her. We always talked to Jeanne and tried never to leave her until she had calmed down. At first, this was very time-consuming and frustrating, for she would often continue fighting her restraints and snapping her chin against her shoulder for 20 to 30 minutes at a time, and everyone wound up exhausted before she had quieted. Slowly, she began to tolerate someone sitting with her without becoming as disturbed. It was then she began to use her pillow to come between her and the outside world. Now, when we were with her, we could loosen her restraints, but not yet remove them. About 4 weeks after we had begun working with Jeanne, she spontaneously put her head in my lap and began sobbing, real tears. This is the first time we had ever seen her cry, and could find no past reports indicating this was usual behavior for her. But she still wanted her pillow. At first, when we got Jeanne up, we were met with great protest. She would now comfortably tolerate us sitting on her bed, but would consistently resist when she was gotten up. We tried to force her as little as possible and did not insist she walk, but at first only stand outside her door with someone while her bed was being changed or her room cleaned. This is about 5 weeks after we started. Jeanne can now be untied when someone is with her, but when you begin to leave, she immediately starts hitting herself. She can be temporarily talked out of it, but within 5 to 10 minutes will not stop unless you tie her or stay with her. She spontaneously puts her hand behind her back as a form of self-restraint. She will now lie quietly and listen to the individual talking to her or the noises in the hall, and occasionally responds by a short laugh or grunt. She still does not want to be touched, however, but will pull away from the irritating agent instead of immediately hitting herself as before. This is several weeks later. There's music playing in the background. This particular evening, Jeanne began bouncing on her bed in time to the music. She is not restrained because someone is with her, but she still prefers to put her hand behind her back. Jeanne now uses occasional words. At first, the lady with her was not bouncing, and Jeanne very clearly said, "Come on, bounce." This activity then continued for over half an hour, with Jeanne laughing much of the time. This is the same evening following the bouncing episode. It is bath time, and Jeanne, for the second time in our experience, began to cry. Now she wants to hang on to people rather than push them away. This is after her bath and she doesn't want her hair brushed. She quite clearly shook her head no when she was asked if she wanted her hair brushed, but we were still unable to realize she could so clearly communicate if she wanted to. Another week later, Jeanne often wanted to stay up after her bath in the evenings and dance to the music. This particular evening, she wasn't in the mood at first and she was being encouraged, but before long, she was able to pick up the rhythm and obviously was enjoying herself. Jeanne has a very good sense of rhythm and rarely misses a beat when keeping time to music. About 3 months after the project began, Jeanne was restrained only a few hours a day. Here she had been unrestrained for several hours, although she still prefers her hand behind her when she isn't tied. She still likes her pillow, but it is over her head much less often. She was asked if she wanted to get up, and she clearly indicated she did. She began marching up and down the hall in time to the background music. But then decided she wanted to bounce instead. Obviously very happy and quite a different girl from only a few months before. This was one of Jeanne's first times outside. As you can see, she just seems to be soaking up the sunshine and fresh air. One of the things that used to bother Jeanne was other children coming near her or anyone interrupting what she was doing with another adult. Here she is quite comfortably able to tolerate such an interruption. The next sequence of shots shows Jeanne playing a game with one of the persons she knows well by now. The woman wanted Jeanne to drink the juice in the glass, and Jeanne knew it. She would take a sip and lie back down, only to sit up and take another sip. Jeanne took another drink and then spit it out on the pillow, both playing a game and simultaneously testing her limits, which at this point were still quite wide. She was then asked if she wanted to get up, and again it was clear she did. On the way up, she grabbed onto her pillow. After she was up and out in the hall, she didn't seem so sure of her decision and was kind of wobbly on her feet. As a reflection of her indecision, she began to hit herself, but was easily talked out of it. She then decided she wanted to sit on the floor, but shortly leaned over and began hitting her head. Again, she was talked out of it, only to strike her head sharply against the nearby chair. This time, she was just reassured that someone was close by, and she stopped on her own. Now Jeanne was transferring some of her attachment of her pillow onto a teddy bear. Sometimes when she would become upset, she would shake her teddy bear and make angry noises, and sometimes bite it or pull out its fur instead of hitting herself. This is one of the first times Jeanne would allow anyone to hold her, and was the beginning of her being able to sit alone, either in a rocking chair or straight chair. When I say alone, I mean Jeanne and her teddy bear were able to sit alone, as the two of them became almost inseparable. Jeanne continued to enjoy her music and would sometimes like to just be with someone and quietly sway in time to the music. Even when sitting alone, she was often swaying with the rhythm of the music while simultaneously keeping track of all of the other activities taking place around her. It's bath time again. Now, Jeanne waits down in the bath area with her teddy bear until rather than striking at herself. She and her teddy bear are still almost constant companions, and Jeanne is almost never restrained. The night before this scene, Jeanne had spent about 30 minutes playing with this rubber squeak dog in her bath. One of the staff members sat on her bed and began squeaking the dog again, and Jeanne soon made a game out of squeaking and then throwing the dog. Jeanne then decided to get up and continue playing with the dog. On this occasion, she let go completely of the person with her while she was holding the dog, but as soon as she had let go, immediately reached out and grabbed hold of the person again. It was dinner time now, and they had to stop playing. Jeanne was very insistent on not letting the person go, but again, could be talked out of it. Again, Jeanne can clearly communicate when she is through eating by pushing the tray away rather than striking herself. There was soft music playing in the background, and Jeanne was relaxed and full. She snuggled up to the staff person with her, but when the record suddenly changed to a very distinct beat, Jeanne preferred to sway to the music than to cuddle. Jeanne has not been cured. Her potential ability to function intellectually or in mature, meaningful human relationships is still unknown. It is clear that Jeanne, in one or more facets of her ego growth and development, failed to achieve at a level consistent for her age. It is not so clear as to what went wrong or why. It is clear that at one point in her life she was able to see and could relate to people and the world, but not in a mature fashion. It is evident that something broke down in her already faulty ego structure, which led to her requiring 24-hour restraint for self-protection, and in spite of these restraints, she was still able to permanently blind herself. It is also clear that Jeanne still retains some of her potential to relate meaningfully to other human beings. How much we can help her regain her former status is still unknown. We cannot restore her vision, and since she is now 14 years old, we may be unable to restore any significant ego functioning, but only time will give us that answer. In the meantime, how many Jeannies are we allowing to develop? How many hopeless, intractable behavior problems are we perpetuating just because we are deaf to the silent screams of a Jeanne who slowly destroyed her vision in a final desperate plea for someone to hear her distress?